You are now rocking Beat Culture on VR1 Radio.
Welcome and thank you for tuning in. This is VR1 Radio, We Are One. Today we look at the life and music of legendary Moses Taiwa Molelekwa. Born in Tembisa in April of 73 to a family of great musicians, it was a no-brainer that Moses would fall in love with music from an early age. Early influences were records played by his father in the house, noting Thelonious Monk as mostly the staple diet. He soon joined the illustrious Fuba Academy, already playing the guitar, to study piano and further his musical knowledge. He credits music as having saved his life during the troubling times of apartheid South Africa. He soon found work at Kippies, and in 88, he joined Brayu Masekela's band and later formed two bands of his own, one of them being Brotherhood. His first studio album came in 95, titled Finding Oneself, which tells a story of self-discovery and receiving great acclaim locally and in Europe. Soon a second album came, titled Jeans and Spirits, which is a rich and versatile repertoire, solidifying his place as an SA great. He expanded his creativity by producing for other artists like Miss Bongile Khumalo and great outfits, to mention one, TKZ. Sadly, on the 30th of Feb 2001, the great and acclaimed Moses Taiwa Molelekwa met his demise, leaving a catalog to be celebrated for many, many generations to come. Himself a believer in reincarnation, one hopes Moses one day comes back. But for now, let us briefly hear from this great, gentle, and very talented soul.
I have many names, but my real name is Jerry Luri Bududu Molelekwa. I am the father of the late Moses Taiwa Molelekwa, who was born in 1973. He was like a miracle child in the family. Moses was the only son that I had. I thought the best thing that we are going to do is to expose him to as much information as there could be. We have already passed 1976. The struggle was going on, but then for kids not to write examination, it was a very big concern for me. So I said, okay, let me make this. For instance, on Saturdays, at least he can go and attend lessons at Fuba. I went into a couple of piano rooms there, and then there was this particular one where I found this young man who was playing busy on the piano. When I looked at Moses, I could see that he was very much fascinated. I said, you see, if you keep on coming here, this is how you'd look like. Once he was 11 years old, for the first 3 months I was accompanying him, you know? And I think after that onwards, he was going there by himself. And I don't remember one time when he said he's not going out there. So I was very much happy that he had that drive already at that age, that he wanted to be in that environment. Because I wanted to be what Moses was as a child. Because in the house, everywhere there was music. We used to sing together as a family. We used to go to church every Sunday. Mr. Spamlau was still the principal there, or the head of Fuba. So he said that it is important when we bring our kids out there, they must have at least something to practice with at home. You know? So I bought him this acoustic guitar. where I bought him most of the sheet music that I wanted him to play. My choice of music, I bought Misty and a number of other standards. And there was like a small brawl, you know, like a horse play. And then the guitar was used and then like somebody wanted to smash, you know, someone with it, and then it broke. And I thought, no, maybe it would be best, because when we bought the guitar, I was desperate to actually get him a piano, but everywhere we went, when we wanted to buy him the upright piano to have in the house, everybody would say the piano is already sold. That is when we were trying to buy from the classified. I bought him a little Casio to keep him going. So many times when he was practicing the scales, he would run out of space because he wanted to really go beyond the size of that keyboard. I think the Casio helped a lot because when he was busy composing some of the songs, one of them was Mountain Shade, he would always call me and say, come and listen to this. How does it sound? I say, no, I don't hear what you're saying. It's not together, it will come together. Don't worry. When he was away, I used to take the book and try a few keys myself, and it was very difficult because Moses, by then, he was playing like six scales and without stopping. But there were times times that we didn't pay for his tuition, he got bursaries. And then Mr. Spamla suggested later sometime that Moses must come in for as a full-time student, because then they were offering a matric. Thank you. like I did not understand what is happening, because maybe our problem was that we listen to a lot of blues music that comes from the US, you know, we listen to a lot of Thelonious Monk, Miles Davis, Dexter Gordon, and a host of other artists out there. Even up to today, I believe that he had not arrived yet, but every time he did something very good, all I could do from behind in the audience, I would always just shed
when
a
you
tear.
Were, so when you were first starting to play, what kind of pianist influenced you as a younger musician?
Yes, well, before I started buying my own records, I had no choice but to listen to Monk and all that my father played, you know.
So your father was the big Monk enthusiast.
Yeah, he is even today. So I mean, it was Monk from my early ages, Horace Silver, Wynton Kelly, you know, those are people I listened to without, you know, any choice, because the music was in the house, so I had to hear it. But I appreciated it. But when I started buying my own records, I went on the one person who, for me, you know, had what I'm looking for and had the sound that I wanted to have and grow on top of is Herbie Hancock. And, you know, there are albums of him with George Benson at a very early age, like they were 24 or something when they did that album, and, you know, just blew my mind to think that at such an early age they were really doing, you know, such stuff. So, you know, that really influenced me, and the way he approaches music, the way he approaches comping, the way he approaches improvisation, you know, I love everything that he does. In his experiments, the way he experiments with different styles of music. I mean, you have Watermelon Man and
Thank you.
70s or so, and they were his then, and even, you know, the young rap guys are still using, you know, his material today, doing remixes and stuff. So Heavy Hancock comes out tops in my line of, you know, in inspirational pianist, but then also from home, Peggy Mseleku, who for me also successfully matched African music and jazz. You know, he writes a Peggy Mseleku style of music. He's a very, very special person, also spiritual. You know, he actually left music for about 2 years to go into a Buddhist temple. See, that's another thing I like. It's the spiritual aspect. There are musicians who spiritually are at a very high level. You know, I was concerned on what musicians really are. Today, you find musicians are as much in a business as an accountant or something, because you have to sell records, you have to do that. But then there's another point in the music. I mean, I went through a couple of books to see how people describe musicians, you know, how people describe music. And I haven't really found a satisfactory answer, but I understand that it's not in one lifetime that one becomes a musician, you know. It's like becoming a master soul, you know. You are born and you heal people, you know, you can do miraculous things. believe in reincarnation, but not as a continuous thing, but you can pass over and you can stay on whatever plane you are. But if you want to come back or you have to come back for whatever reason, you can get the permission to do that, you know. So I feel like musicians, it's not only in one lifetime that you become a musician. It's sort of, you know, going through a couple of lifetimes, because I believe this world has been like this before. You know, there's been great cities, there's been everything that's happening now has happened before, and it's evolving. Though there are changes in the way people treat each other or look at each other, we still face the problems that, you know, the older generations, the past generations faced as well. And this world may end, and then, you know, the, maybe this or the earth, you know, like the end of the world the first time with the floods and whatever, it can happen again. But I think people will still be people, you know, and they'll still come back, and we may be given fresh land and fresh water maybe every 500 or whatever years, you know, but we'll keep on coming back. So I find that musicians have a certain spiritual element that comes out through their music. And I find that Begim Selwegu, somehow I haven't really sat down with him and found out from him, but I feel that he may be able to explain, you know, a lot of things to me. He's a multi-instrumentalist, you know, he plays every instrument, and he doesn't just play it, you know, he can go and do, he can decide to become a full-time saxophone player, or a full-time guitar player, or full-time drummer, you know. So I think spiritually he's at a very high level for him to learn all those instruments and master them in this lifetime. To me, tells me that he's been here before, you know, maybe 2-3 times before, I don't know. I love his music, also the way he uses traditional music and fuses it with jazz, and he just brings out a certain element, and in my music as well I try and do the same thing. So it's following in the lines of two people, that's Begum Seleku and Heavy Hancock, and then there's Abdullah, my grandfather reminded me of him, or I don't know, now that he's gone, I think he reminds me of my grandfather, because he used to play that kind of Marabi style. And it's music from a certain era and from a certain age that's been preserved. But Abdullah also is an innovator, you know, in his composition style and his simplicity. I love his simplicity.
Thank you. up.
So in that way also, it does really influence me. So I can only name those three for now, but there are 100 others. As I said, if I hear a good thing, I'll try and work on it, try understand it and work on it. So there are other influences, but these are the main ones.
son of the late Thelonious Monk came here. He went to Fuba to get some students that could go overseas to learn or to give them bursaries. As he was growing, was to do music for films, and that is why he very much wanted to go to Berkeley, the Berkeley School of Music. And then Moses told me that no, he's been selected to go to that academy somewhere in the US to go and further his studies. So he said, but there is another offer that he needs to go. He has to choose between going to school and doing a recording. And I did not know that he was actually influenced, because later on when I spoke to Robert, he told me that he talked him out of it, because what he was going to learn there he already had. I cannot compromise. This is an opportunity for me to do my own album. It is the biggest opportunity. It is a dream come true. Yes.
This is VR1 Radio, Mix Radio.